Approximately 3,900 years ago, a powerful volcanic eruption occurred on the west coast of the United States. This sent a plume of ash high into the atmosphere, scorched more than 100 square miles of forest, and caused measurable ash to fall as far away as Edmonton and a section of Canada's Northwest Territories. This did not occur due to the caldera-forming eruption of Crater Lake, as that occurred approximately 3,900 years earlier, but rather due to the largest known explosive eruption of Mount Saint Helens. And, despite the size of this eruption, which was 11.5 times larger than what it produced in 1980, the volcano did not collapse into a caldera. This is the story of the so-called Wayan Tephra. The Wayan Tephra eruption was like many other large Mount St. Helens eruptions, as it produced large volumes of a pumice with a dacite composition. Although the full extent of ash fell heavy enough to accumulate and leave behind a layer thick enough to remain in the geologic record is unclear, the Wayan Tephra covers an area of at least 750,000 square kilometers, as during the eruption the ash cloud was directed to the north-northeast by strong winds, causing the ash to cover large swaths of Canada. While areas as far away as Mount Rainier received 20 inches of ash, areas up to 25 miles away received up to 3.5 feet of ash, and on the slopes of Mount St. Helens, areas received up to 9 feet thick of ash. For context, the thickest layers of ash produced in its 1980 eruption only were approximately 34 inches thick. While ash during the 1980 eruption of Mount St. Helens fell as far away as Oklahoma, at this distance it only left behind a few particles. Thus, if we were to look at the 1980 ash fallout map several thousand years from now and did not look at human records of the event in the same way we look at the Wayan eruption, its ash fallout would look like this, aka the 1980 eruption, while still large, only covered a fraction of the area the 1860 BCE eruption did. One reason that the Wayan Tephra eruption was so large was that although it was not the first eruption of a new eruptive period, it occurred in a geologically short time span after a nearly 7,000-year-long dormancy period with no eruptions at this volcano. During this time, not only had Mount St. Helens received a steady influx of molten rock at depth, causing its magma chamber to greatly expand, but its magma chamber had also built up in volatiles and became more silica-rich. Because so much material was present, it allowed for very large eruptions to eventually occur. This is why the largest and third largest explosive volcanic eruptions from Mount St. Helens during the Holocene Epoch all occurred during the same eruptive period, which was known as the Smith Creek period. At the time when this eruption began 3,900 years ago, Mount St. Helens did not have the symmetrical profile associated with it today, or its infamous northward-facing breach crater. Rather, while it did have the triangular shape of a stratovolcano, it looked more like a blocky complex of overlapping lava domes. It was also only 6,000 to 7,000 feet in height at the time. When the catastrophic Wayan eruption of Mount St. Helens occurred in 1860 BCE, it sent a sustained plume of ash into the atmosphere to a height of 31 kilometers or 102,000 feet. For context, this was 26,000 feet higher than the eruption column in 1980. Large swaths of this column collapsed back to the ground, and part of the volcano figuratively boiled over, creating long traveling pyroclastic flows which raced across the landscape at a speed of 100 miles per hour. These would go on to reach up to 12 miles or 20 kilometers distant, being primarily directed to the north. In total, 15.3 cubic kilometers of tephra was ejected, meaning the eruption was assigned a volcanic explosivity index rating of a 6. Thanks for watching. If you would like to request a specific topic, please leave a comment below. Additionally, I would like to thank this channel's patrons on Patreon and channel members on YouTube.